on this.
Good morning, majority. Would all who are able please stand for the reading of the scripture? This morning I'll be reading from 1 Peter, 2nd chapter, the 22nd through the 24th verses. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. That's good news, majority. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with humble hearts, praising and worshiping your holy and righteous name. Heavenly Father, we know that we are not worthy of your glory and honor. But we ask that you would forgive us for our sins and help us all to lead better lives. Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to come into your house another day to fellowship together. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who are unable to attend this morning. We pray that you wrap your arms of protection and healing around them, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who are on the way. We also ask that you wrap your arms of protection around them and grant them your traveling mercy. Father, we've been through a storm, but you brought us through once again. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for your many blessings. Heavenly Father, we ask that as we come to lift up your name and to praise you, that you would touch our hearts and touch our minds, that we may carry your word with us as we go throughout the week. Help us, Heavenly Father, to not only be good Christians on Sunday, but every day, Heavenly Father. Help us to reach out to those who do not know your Son Jesus and the free pardon of their sins, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, as we get closer to electing our leaders, Heavenly Father, please let us all know that you are our ultimate leader. You are our Father, and that you will make it right. Heavenly Father, when at last we come to the end of our journey here on earth, we ask that you grant us all a home in your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, we humbly pray. Amen.
Good morning, majority. Good morning. We're going to try something a little different this morning, but we ask that everyone join in with us as we sing this opening selection.
I just want to praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me.
Blessings and glory.
Blessings and glory and honor. They all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus. I just want to praise you
forever,
and forever,
and ever,
and ever,
and ever,
and ever, for all you've done for me.
Blessings and glory.
Blessings and glory.
And honor.
And honor.
For blessing me.
For blessing me.
Oh,
just want to praise you
forever.
Forever.
And ever.
And ever.
And ever.
And ever. For all
you've
done for me.
Blessings and glory.
Blessings and glory.
And honor.
And honor.
They all
belong to you.
of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
From this time forth, yes, and forevermore, hallelujah, the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Amen.
From the rising of the sun, yes, until the going down of the same,
yes,
the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Yes.
Now let's put those Holy Ghost hands together and praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven,
yes,
hallowed be thy name.
Yes.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Yes.
For you watched over us all night long, and you woke us up with a finger of love. You allow us to see the dawn of a new day. Only your grace, unmerited favor, God, we don't deserve it, but you saw fit to have mercy on us. Our Heavenly Father, you allowed us to travel the highways and byways, and you allowed no hurt, harm, or danger to come to us. So we thank you, God, for allowing us to come to your house this morning. When we entered the doorway, the Holy Spirit was already here.
Yes.
And because the Holy Spirit is here, we know that love, joy, and peace abide. Because the Holy Spirit is here, we know that true worship will take place. Now, Heavenly Father, it's our prayer that you will use your woman servant this morning to do your will and to do your way, that you will speak through her in a mighty way, that we as your people will live better lives here on earth according to your will and your way. These and all the blessings I ask in your precious name, and for your sake I pray. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, would you meet and greet your neighbor?
Only do it.
Won't he do it? Yes, he will. Yes, he will. At this time, we'd like to recognize our visitors. If you're a visitor majority for the first time, would you just raise your hand to be recognized at this time? If you visit a majority for the first time. All right, I guess you've either been here before or this is your home. So we're just going to give ourselves a hand for you today. If you remember, and this is your first time back, would you either wave your hand this morning or stand? All right, we are all at home. So we're just so glad to see each other, and it's a blessing to be in the house of God. So let's give ourselves a hand one more time. Amen. Amen. At this time, we will have our greetings done by another than our pastor, Reverend Dr. Marcel Bush. Let us receive him as he comes with a genuine smile on our face and the clapping of our hands. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to be in the house on this beautiful Kingdom Casual Sunday. Good to be here this morning, and it's good to see each and every one of you. I hope that you've had a blessed week and that you're looking forward to another great week that is coming up here. And certainly we want to thank God for the blessings of this day. And I want to just give another quick shout out to all of our October birthdays. If we didn't get a chance to tell you on last Sunday, we say happy birthday to you. I know that Sister Crystal, Crystal and Donye is celebrating today. So happy birthday to Sister Crystal. Amen. Amen. And to all October birthdays and October anniversaries, we say happy anniversary to you one more time on this wonderful day and Sunday morning. Let me just share a few words with you, brothers and sisters. Number one, we do want to keep several families lifted in our prayers that are going through seasons of bereavement. First of all, we want to continue to keep Sister Elizabeth Jones in our prayers. She lost her mother. Excuse me, I made a mistake there. Sister Dorothy Jones is our member, and she lost her mother, Sister Elizabeth Jones, and we want to keep the Jones family lifted in our prayers. And her homegoing celebration will be today, 2 p.m. at New Day Baptist Church. So let us please keep Sister Dorothy Jones and the entire Jones family in our prayers. Also, we lost one of our members this week on this past Friday, Mrs. Vernice Thompson. And at this time, the funeral arrangements are incomplete. So we want to, again, keep that family in our prayers. And let us continue to keep Sister Tia Means in our prayers as well. She lost her uncle, Brother Robert Lee Boyd Sr. in Norfolk, Virginia. So all of these families, and even those that I have not mentioned here this morning, let us continue to keep them in our thoughts and in our prayers. Amen? Amen. Amen. And we thank you for working with us this morning. Our minister of music is on vacation. And we were hoping, we had scheduled to have a musician here this morning, but unfortunately, they were not able to be with us this morning. They had to postpone or cancel. So we appreciate our music ministry. Let's give God some praise for our music ministry this morning, doing a beautiful job, doing a beautiful job, beautiful voices. And we know that God always makes a way. Amen. 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 Let me also say just a few other things. Our quarterly church meeting is right after these services, and I want to ask all members to please stay. We're not going to keep you all morning or afternoon. We're going to get right down to business, but I do want to ask all members to please stay for that meeting right after these services. Also, our trunk or treat and giveaway is on next Sunday, so everybody plan to come. There's going to be a giveaway next Sunday of toiletries and other household supplies. There's going to be a box lunch provided. And we want to thank Sister Delina Young and her family for providing that for us on next Sunday. Let's give God praise. Amen, Sister Young. Thank you so much for what you are doing. And we also want to ask every member on next Sunday, bring some bagged, wrapped candy, because once you get your goodies from the gymnasium, we want to then proceed outside and give away candy to our children, our young people, and again, maybe some of us that are not so young, we want to give away our treats on next Sunday. So let us bring candy, and we'll send announcements out and reminders about that this week. Also, next Sunday as well is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And we're going to be observing breast cancer awareness. We're going to have a special speaker and guest on next Sunday. And we're asking everyone to wear pink, or if you can wear a pink ribbon on next Sunday, we would appreciate that so very, very much. Now, let me say one last thing before we move forward with the rest of our worship service. We all know what's getting ready to happen tomorrow. Amen? Amen. Tomorrow is voting time. Amen. I am excited. And beginning tomorrow, early voting starts in South Carolina, and it goes from the 21st through November the 2nd. Let me give you the locations. In Spartanburg, you can vote at the County Voter Registration and Election Office at 366 North Church Street. In Boylan Springs, you can vote at the library, which is 871 Double Bridge Road in Boylan Springs. In Middle Tiger, in Lyman, it's the Middle Tiger Library at 170 Gross Road in Lyman. And if you're in Woodruff, you can vote at the Woodruff Library. That's 270 East Haynes Street in Woodruff. Now, brothers and sisters, we've said it all along. This is an important election, and the stakes could not be higher. Amen? They could not be higher, and we have to do everything we can. Let us make sure that we, number one, vote early if you can, and I want to encourage everybody who can to vote early, and then get it out of the way. And then what you can do the rest of the voting season is spend time encouraging, telling others, friends, family, to get out to the polls and vote, and also helping them to get to the polls. Now, if anybody needs a ride to the polls, my number is in the bulletin on the back. Just call me. We'll make sure we get you to the polls. Call me, we'll get you to the polls. If I have to drive you myself, I don't mind. Trust me, I voted on Thursday. Amen. I'm excited. We were the first day of voting in North Carolina was on Thursday. We were able to get out and vote on Thursday. It felt so good to walk in and cast our votes. Now, I'm going to say one other quick thing. Now, we've been talking about Project 2025. And I cannot tell you who to vote for. I can't endorse a candidate. But it's good that we stay informed. Amen? And I want you to do everything you can. Not only do we want to vote for the presidential office, but make sure that we're voting all the way down your ballot. Make sure that even the down ballot races, that we don't ignore them, but that we also vote for them as well. And if you want information, I'm going to say this for Kamala Harris, go to KamalaHarris.com. Now, there's some other things that I just want to say very quickly that I thought was very interesting about Project 2025. And there are just a few things that I want to lift up to you that Project 2025 will do. And I just want you to listen, just a few things. Number one, it will destroy the Department of Education. All right, hello somebody. It will end Head Start, and it will end Pell Grants. Hello somebody. Young people that are going to college, we know if I didn't have Pell Grants when I was going to college, I don't know. But thankfully, those grants were there. So brothers and sisters, a lot is at stake. Also, it will enforce, I'm going to say this again, enforce the death penalty. And we know that more black men are in prison and on death row than any other demographic group in this country. Amen, somebody. Amen. It will end loan forgiveness for student loans. It will end equal employment opportunity, which means we will no longer have protection against discrimination on man. No longer will we have those types of protection against discrimination on the job. It will end Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act. So those of us who are on Obamacare, I'm going to raise my hand. It will end Obamacare and the Affordable Care Act. It will end the $35 cap on insulin. How many of us know people with diabetes? So it'll end that cap in terms of insulin. It will end or lower Social Security payments and privatize them. It will end and lower Medicare and Medicaid. It will also lower taxes once again for the rich and for corporations, and it will not lower taxes for the poor or middle class. Do I need to say anything else? Brothers and sisters, the stakes are high, and they are not playing around, and we know whose agenda this is. But once again, brothers and sisters, and if he gets back in office, he intends on putting this agenda in action. So brothers and sisters, whoever you choose to vote for, vote. But I just want us to be informed in terms of what is at stake in this election. So are we going to get out and vote tomorrow, brothers and sisters? Amen. Let's get out and exercise our right to vote. Amen. Amen. Our ancestors, our forefathers, and some people maybe even sitting in this sanctuary or watching us on video this morning have bled, died, fought, sacrificed for our right to vote. And so, brothers and sisters, the least we can do right now in 2024 is go to the polls and exercise our rights, because your vote is your voice and your vote is your power. Amen. And we're going to show up at the polls, and we're going to show out at the polls in 2024. Amen. We're serious. They might be serious, but we're serious too. Amen? Amen. Let's go win this election, brothers and sisters. May God bless you. We have a dynamic preacher who is here this morning. Let's give God praise for Reverend Audrey Grant, who is going to bring the word to us this morning. I'm excited, and I know she came here with a word in her heart. And what I want to do, I don't need to introduce her. She is a daughter of this house, and she is the president of our Christian Congress of Christian Education for the Spartanburg County Baptist Association. She is an associate minister here at Majority Baptist Church, and she is a strong laborer in the kingdom of God. Amen. And she is a call preacher, and I know she's going to have a word for us this morning. So as she comes today, I want you to pray for her in advance. And when she comes, let us tune our ears and our hearts in, and let us get with her and get behind her as she brings the word of God this morning. Let's give God some praise one more time for the preacher and for the word of God. We're going to ask everyone, as we prepare to give God our tithes and our offering, I want to encourage us to let us be faithful as we give. Let us be generous as we give. May we all stand who are able as we prepare to give back a portion of what God has given unto us. Let us pray. Merciful God, Father, we come again at this hour to say thank you. We thank you, God, for this privilege, this opportunity to give back a portion of what you have given unto us. Allow this tithe and this offering to be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom. It is in the precious name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much.
want some more of that? Are y'all sure y'all want some more of that?
Today, but it's so much easier to say tomorrow. Who promised you tomorrow? Better choose the Lord today, for tomorrow very well might be too late. Jesus said, here I stand, won't you please take my hand? And you said, I will tomorrow. Jesus said, I am he who supplies all your needs. And you said, I know. But tomorrow, oh, tomorrow, I'll give my life tomorrow. I thought about today, but it's so much easier to say tomorrow. Who promised you tomorrow? Better choose the Lord today, for tomorrow very well might be too late. And who said tomorrow would ever come for you? Still you laugh and play and continue on to say, tomorrow, forget about tomorrow. Won't you give your life today? Oh, please, don't just turn and walk away. Tomorrow, tomorrow is not promised. Don't let this moment slip away. Tomorrow could very well begin today.
Tomorrow.
Yes.
Tomorrow is not promised to either of us. So let us, while we have breath in our bodies, give God a hand praise today. Thank him for this day. Thank him for waking us up this morning.
thank him for starting us on our way and coming to the house of the Lord. Give God another hand, praise, because we're still standing. Unlike the trees that fell away from our house, we're still standing. Praise the Lord. I love you. I love you. Good morning. Majority Baptist Church, to our beloved pastor, Pastor Bush, and as we give honor to God, our Savior, our Maker, Jesus Christ, we greet you this morning. We greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior. Yes. To those who are joining us via our teleconference, we say good morning and thank you for being with us on this great day. As we have gathered here on this day, we want to give honor to all of our ministers in the pulpit and in the audience. We said thank you. Our deacons, our trustees, our missionaries, our ushers, and our beloved choir ministry, we love you and we thank you. There is a word from the Lord this morning. Somebody said, there is a word. And it comes to us from Mark, the first chapter, verses 16 through 20. And because of the words that are used in this scripture, I have requested Pastor the King James Version. Amen. The word reads thusly, and if you see the word, say amen. If you have it in your Bible, say amen, if you're there. Mark, first chapter, verses 16 through 20. And the word says, now as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea. For they were what? Fishers. Fishers. And Jesus said unto them, come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. Fishers of men. And straightway they forsook their nets and followed him. And when they had gone a little further thence, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who also were in the ship, mending their nets. And what? Straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him. The title of this morning's message is Walking with Jesus, the Price of Sacrifice.
All right. Amen.
May we pray. Eternal God, our Father, we just thank you, O Lord, for this day. Thank you, O God, for allowing us to come once again to your house of worship. And so, Father, we come asking that the Holy Spirit will prevail in this place, O God. Have your way, O Lord, so that everything that is done and said will be pleasing in your sight. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Walking with Jesus, the price of sacrifice. Subtitle, the one that I hope you'll take home with you, simply put, it pays to follow Jesus. It pays to follow Jesus. My brothers and my sisters, as you all know, everything comes with a cost. Everything comes with a cost. When we're out shopping, the first thing that we look at is the price tag. Am I right about it? First thing that we look at is the price tag. At this point, we're asking ourselves several questions. How much is this? How much will I have to pay? How will this impact my budget? Is the cost too much for me to pay? It looks good. I really want it. But can I afford this?
Is my sacrifice to pay for this more than I can bear? How much am I willing to give up in order to obtain this? Is my sacrifice worth the item? Unfortunately, my brothers and my sisters, this type of decision making is not just relegated to our everyday shopping experiences. This type of thinking and questioning is not just what we do in our day-to-day lives under ordinary circumstances. It is often what many may think when it comes to following Jesus. These same questions may find their way into the minds and hearts of many Christians who may give lip service to the question, am I a true follower of Jesus Christ? And many may proclaim that they are true followers, but deep down they doubt their own words and often seek deeper understanding of what it takes to be a true follower of Jesus Christ. Yes. Which takes us to our relevant question this morning. What must I do to follow Jesus? Yes. What must I do to follow and live my life as Jesus would have me to? Well, as our beloved Pastor Bush would often say, I'm glad you asked that question. Let us go to our scripture this morning and find the answer to our question, what must I do to follow Jesus? Our scripture comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 16 through 20. The Gospel of Mark, the second book of the New Testament, portrays the person of Jesus Christ as the Son of the Living God. This book was written around AD 60 to 67, and the purpose of the writing of the book, Mark wants to show that Jesus is the true and living God. The book of Mark portrays Jesus in a very realistic environment, walking and talking with ordinary people in their everyday life. There is a sense of urgency, immediacy in this particular book in the Bible. We often see the use of the word straightway, immediately and forthwith, being used over 30 times. Hence, we see that Mark is almost traveling beside Jesus as he moves from one location to the other, as Jesus begins his ministry. And so we see then, first of all, what was Jesus doing in this scripture? In this morning text, Mark 16 through 20 verses, we see Jesus walking by the Sea of Galilee. We see Jesus walking by the Sea of Galilee. And let me invite you that our text comes from the first chapter of Mark, and a number of things have happened before we get to verses 16 and 20. And we see that Jesus Christ is now beginning to enter into his ministry, and he is now moving and walking around the Sea of Galilee. Yes. You say, Grant, why is walking so important? Why are we emphasizing the fact that Jesus is walking beside the Sea of Galilee? Walking means much more than physically moving from one place to another. It symbolizes the way we live. Walking symbolizes the way we live. Walking with someone denotes a closeness, a relationship. Many times we walk with others as a part of our daily exercise routine. When we walk, we talk. When we talk, we become closer. As a child growing up, I remember my mother singing that old familiar song, "Just a Closer Walk with Thee." Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to Thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Walking means closeness. Walking means a connection. Walking means a relationship is developing here. We are not walking in silence, but as we are walking, we're talking. And while we're walking, I'm teaching. And while I'm teaching, you're learning. So there is a purpose for walking. There is a purpose for Jesus's walking. So when we speak of walking this text today, we see so much more than ordinary walking as a means of exercise or recreation. Jesus is walking with a purpose. Jesus is walking with a reason. Yes. You may ask yourself, well, why the Sea of Galilee? Why is he walking beside the Sea of Galilee? The Sea of Galilee is mentioned many times throughout the New Testament, but it's not always called the Sea of Galilee. Sometimes it's called Lake Gennesaret and the Sea of Tiberias. But I ask you to remember from your biblical studies that the Sea of Galilee is not a very large body of water. It is only 13 miles from north to south and 8 miles from east to west. Would not even be considered a sea in today's context. But we see that the sea is the location for other people to have come, and this is an area that is heavily populated. There are many people who have built their homes around the Sea of Galilee. So we see as Jesus is not walking by the Sea of Galilee, he knows that there are many people that he will encounter as he is walking by the sea. As he is walking and looking and searching for those who will become his disciples to carry his ministry forward. So we see why Jesus is walking. We see where he's walking. Now let us see whom he calls. Now as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. Our first point this morning, my brothers and sisters, Jesus calls ordinary people to do extraordinary things. Let us look at the call and who Jesus called. Jesus called simple men. Simple from the context, no, they were not stupid or ignorant, but they were matter of fact and practical in their work. They were not your religious leaders, Reverend Moore. They were not the powerful men, Pastor Bush, that we've referred to in the political realm of today's society. They were not of the priestly and ministerial profession. They were not ministers, doctors, lawyers, educators, professors, businessmen. They were not students in the schools of higher learning. Very simply, they were ordinary men. Simple laymen engaged in the affairs of life like all the laymen of their day. Having said this, however, a question needs to be asked. If these men were just ordinary people, why did Jesus call them instead of calling the more gifted? The answer lies in some very special qualities that made them stand out from the average layman. This passage gives a picture of these qualities, a picture of the kind of person Jesus calls. Somebody say, the kind of person Jesus calls. They were industrious, hardworking men, casting their nets into the sea day after day, trying to make a living was a hard and tedious task. Every day they were beside the seashore, casting their nets, trying to pull in a day's worth of food. What they ate was determined by what they caught. What they ate was determined by what they caught. No catch, no eat. Jesus saw how hard Simon and Andrew were working. He saw their industriousness. He saw how they were dedicated to their work. A little farther up the lake, he saw James and John, his brother, also two industrious laymen mending their nets. Note that the first call is to become fishers of men, not to become teachers, preachers, counselors, administrators, builders, and or fundraisers. The first call to be fishers of men. Yet how easily we obscure and camouflage the evangelism ministry in our churches. We must be about our Father's business, which is to bring souls to Jesus Christ. We're all fishers of men, bringing souls to Jesus Christ through our conversation, through our prayers, through our study, and witnessing to others.
We all are charged with the responsibility and opportunity to tell the good news of Jesus Christ. Turn to your neighbor and say, I am a fisherman. I am a fisherman. Our second point is we must be willing to work for Jesus Christ. Jesus has no use for the lazy, slow-moving, sloppy, nonchalant, disinterested, uncommitted workman. The person who Jesus calls is an industrious, hard-working person. A study of God's call throughout Scripture makes this fact very clear. If we will look at the call of Amos in chapter 7, verse 14, he says, I was no prophet, neither was I a prophet's son, but I was a herdsman and a gatherer of sycamore fruit. And the Lord took me up as I followed the flock. And the Lord said unto me, go, prophesy unto my people Israel, a herdsman. Elisha's call. Elisha was plowing in the field with 12 yoke of oxen before him when the prophet Elijah passed by him and cast his mantle upon him. Ordinary people called to do extraordinary things. We all must go forth and do the work of ministry. We can no longer talk about it, but we must do the work Jesus has called each of us to do. Each of us has been called. Am I right about it? The disciples of Jesus were visionary men, men who were looking for the Messiah and ready to follow him no matter the cost. These men were willing to sacrifice all that they had to follow Jesus. Few people have a strong vision, a vision so strong that they are willing to pay any price to follow Jesus. Our third point is we must be willing to sacrifice for Jesus. We must be willing to sacrifice for Jesus. Giving up their profession or business, family or friends, they knew that Jesus was the Messiah. James and John, despite their success, were sacrificial when it came to following Jesus Christ. And the last verse, verse 20, says to us, and straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him. James and John sacrificed their livelihood and their relationship with their father to follow Jesus. They loved their father and left him in the care of the servants. How many persons would make this kind of sacrifice? The question takes us back to the relevant question for today's message. What must I do to walk with Jesus? We must always remember three things. The first one, walking with Jesus ain't easy. Walking with Jesus ain't easy. Many times in life, we are going to have to walk through some tough times. We're going to have to walk through some trials and some tribulations. Sometimes we may not know how we're going to make ends meet. Sometimes we may not know how our health is going to hold out. Sometimes you may not know how you're going to get a job or how to keep a job. But his word has said, I once was young and now I'm old, but I have never seen the righteous forsaken nor his seed begging bread. The Lord will make a way out of no way if we'll just walk with him. Walking with Jesus means that we are to be in a close relationship with him. Walking with Jesus means that we have to walk hand in hand with the Savior. We must pray and we must obey. We must obey God, our Heavenly Father. Many times we get out of step with God when we disobey God. Many times we want to get ahead of God because we are impatient and we want to do it our way. Many times we get out of step with God and want to lag behind. Many times we lag behind and drag our feet because we're stubborn and have a hard head. We lag behind when God calls us to do his will. We make excuses for lagging behind and not doing the work of the ministry, helping our neighbors and loving them as ourselves. Many will say, I'm too tired. I've been working all day and I need to get some rest. Many will say, I'm too busy. Let me check my schedule and I'll get back to you. Many will say, I'm too old. I ain't what I used to be and I can't do the things I used to do. Stop making excuses for answering the call of Jesus. Each of us has a call on our lives. Abraham was 75 years old, but he still obeyed God's will. Moses was 80 years old when God called him to lead the Israelites out of slavery in Egypt. Noah was 126 years old when he finished building the ark to protect the people from the flood. Just like Jesus called each disciple, he is calling each of us today. Come, take up your cross and follow me. Stop making excuses for what we can do today. I'm so glad that Jesus didn't make an excuse for doing his Father's will. I'm so glad that Jesus was obedient to the Father when he said, Father, not my will, but thy will be done. Not my will, but thy will be done. I'm so glad that Jesus took the final walk for you and the final walk for me. The final walk up Calvary's Hill, he walked while carrying his cross. He walked while the cross was heavy, but he walked on anyhow. He walked while they beat him, but he walked on anyhow. He walked while they spat on him, but he walked on anyhow. And as he hung on Calvary's cross, he lifted his eyes to heaven and said, Father, Father, I commend to thy hands, I commend my spirit. And saying this, he gave up the ghost. They buried him in a borrowed tomb. He stayed Friday, he stayed Saturday. But early, early that Sunday morning, he got up with all power. Power to destroy and power to defend. But that's not the end of the story, because he's coming back again. He's coming back for you and he's coming back for me. Every eye shall see him, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that he, Jesus Christ, is Lord. Don't you want to see him? Don't you want to meet him? Don't you want to meet him in the air? It pays to follow Jesus, no matter the cost, the price of sacrifice. Jesus has paid the debt through his blood, through his redeeming blood. And for that, we give him praise, because every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Let us sing with uplift voices as we continue to move forward with our service on this day. Every praise is to our God. Stand on your feet and put those Holy Ghost hands together. Yes, every praise is to our God. This is a day of celebration. Yes, walking with Jesus, the price of sacrifice. Everyone, your voices.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah,
sing hallelujah
to our God. Glory, hallelujah is to our God.
Doors of the church are standing open. Won't you come today? If you don't have a relationship, the doors are open. You can come by water baptism, Christian experience. You may come.
Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God.
Anyone desiring prayer, we invite you to come to the altar. Anyone desiring prayer.
Glory, hallelujah, is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is
still time.
God,
there's still time. You can come.
Healer.
You can come. Anyone who's standing in need of prayer, if there's a member of the family, if there's a family in particular, an individual who's standing in need in prayer this morning, can we just pause right now and call their name publicly or silently? Can we call their names right now? Let us pray. Merciful God, Father, we come again. First of all, God, we honor you and we praise you because you, God, are worthy of the praise. If we had 1,000 tongues, we could not thank you enough. So God, we just say thank you right now for your grace and your mercy. Father God, right now we thank you for this opportunity to come to this altar. We thank you, God, because we realize that you are a Father who has the power to take care of us. And Father, we thank you right now because you know what our needs are. And not only do you know our needs, but you know how to handle them. And you know how to deliver. So God, right now, we ask that you would first of all look into our hearts and forgive us for our sins. Help us, God, to be better this day than we were on yesterday. Yes. And Father, we ask that you would clean our hearts. Yes. And help us, God, to draw closer to you right now. Father, right now, we ask that you would just look upon those, the names that have been called in this altar, the names that have been called around this sanctuary, and the names that have been called of those who are watching us online. Father, we ask that you would just move in only the way that you can. We ask, Father, those who are sick this morning, we pray for divine healing and divine deliverance. Father, those who are suffering from broken relationships, we ask right now that you would just put them back together right now in only the way that you can. Lord, we ask those that are suffering from financial difficulties that you would open up windows of heaven and pour out blessings. Whatever our needs are, we don't know every need, but God, you know all about us. And we know again that you can provide for every need. We ask, Father, that you would bless those families that are walking through seasons of bereavement right now. Continue, God, to touch them, strengthen them, comfort them, go with them, walk with them today. We ask, God, that you would look on the absent part of our church family. Many are sick. But God, we realize that again, you are a healer today. So, Father, we ask that you would visit bedsides, that you would go right now and touch them, and that you would heal them. Give them everything that they need. And in advance of every good blessing, God, we just say thank you. We thank you because we know that you're able to provide. So continue, Father, to walk with us. Protect us. Continue to draw us closer to you. It is in the precious name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, that we pray this prayer in faith. Amen. Amen. Amen and amen. God bless you. Come on, let's give God some praise in this place. Amen. 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 God bless you. God bless you, brothers and sisters. We thank God. Let's give God praises again for the preacher of the hour. Thank you so much, Reverend Grant, for letting God use you this morning. And as I always say, just keep on preaching. Keep on preaching. Thank you. There is a cost to follow him. And God is expecting us to do the assignment and the work that he has given us to do. And the good news is, as the preachers reminded us, God is still with us. He's still right here. And he will give us the ability, the power to do everything that he has told us and commanded us to do. God bless you, preacher. We thank God for you. We thank God again for our music ministry. Amen. Did a beautiful job. Beautiful job. Amen. Thank you so very much. And thank you, Majority Family. We want to remind you that right after this service, we're going to go directly into, we're not going to keep you all day, I promise. We're going to move this, our meeting along, but we're going to have our quarterly meeting. And we ask that all members please stay for just a little while we go through some business that we need to take care of. Amen? Amen. Amen. Don't forget to vote. Voting starts tomorrow. I know some of us have already voted. Reverend and Sister Moore told me they've already voted. And mailed in their ballot. Amen. God bless you, Reverend Moore and Sister Moore. And let us all follow suit beginning tomorrow, the 21st through November 2nd, through November the 2nd. So vote early. Tell everybody, you know, whether they live in South Carolina, we need everybody's vote. Amen. Amen. Everybody. If they live out of state, call them. Tell them. If you live in Michigan, we need you to vote. If you live in North Carolina, Georgia, wherever you live, let us tell all of our family members, our friends, neighbors, co-workers, please, please, brothers and sisters, we need everybody to get out and do what we know is the right thing to do. Amen? Amen. Amen. We love you. Invite somebody to church next week. Next week is Pink Sunday. It's Trunk or Treat Sunday. It's also, we're going to be giving away toiletries, a box lunch, and those toiletries will be given away as long as those supplies last. So invite somebody to church on next Sunday. Let us look to the Lord to be dismissed. And now may the grace of God, the love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide in this God's people, now and forevermore. Let us all say together, amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you and thank you.